Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Chinese University of Hong Kong. Attending the United College Distinguished Visiting Scholar Lecture in 2015 to 2016. I'm Toby Lau, Year 4 student from the Biomedical Engineering Program, Master of Ceremony for today's lecture. Before the lecture commences, may I have your cooperation in switching off your mobile phones, pagers, or other beeping devices, or have them turned to the silent mode. The United College Distinguished Visiting Scholar Scheme is made possible by the generous support of the College's Endowment Fund. Under this scheme, United College is able to invite well-renowned scholars to Hong Kong to give public lectures and meet staff and students of the college and the university. This year, United College has much privilege to have invited Professor Ines Fung from the University of California, Berkeley, as our Distinguished Visiting Scholar in 2015 to 2016. Without further ado, I would like to turn the floor to the moderator of today's lecture, Professor Amos Tai from the Earth System Science Program of the Chinese University of Hong Kong. May I now call upon Professor Tai to introduce Professor Ines Fung and the topic of this afternoon. Professor Tai, please.
Thank you very much. I'm extremely honored to be here to introduce Professor Ines Fung, Fung Yao Suan Gao Sao, to every one of you. And she's the distinguished visiting lecturer, visiting scholar of United World College, and also a leading expert in the field of Earth and atmospheric sciences. Professor Fung was born and raised in Hong Kong. And she'd like me to highlight this year, she has got some schoolmates here today, and she'd like me to highlight she went to the True Light Primary School and Mary Knoll Sisters School from Form 1 to Form 5, and then she matriculated from in Lower 6 and Upper 6 from the King's College, all right? And afterwards, she went to the United States for her college, and she got both her bachelor and doctorate degrees from MIT. She's indeed the second woman to graduate from MIT with a doctorate degree in meteorology. That's really a big deal. And afterward, she's been to a couple of prominent places, including Columbia University, the NASA Goddard Institute for Space Study in New York City, and then University of Victoria. In 1998, she moved to University of California, Berkeley, UC Berkeley, and was appointed as the Richard and Rhoda Goldman Distinguished Professor in the Physical Sciences. She's now currently holding joint appointment as a professor in UC Berkeley in the Department of Earth and Planetary Science, as well as the Department of Environmental Science, Policy and Management. Over her long and very productive career, she's made tremendous contribution to the scientific community. She's really the pioneer in the new and exciting field of biogeoscience. She has done pioneering work to bring the global carbon cycle into climate and Earth system model, really helping us to enhance our understanding of the impacts of human activities on our environment and the climate. She has earned, for her research and teaching, she has earned numerous awards and honors, which are basically too numerous to list individually here. So here, I would just like to highlight a few. She is a fellow in both the American Meteorological Society, the American Geophysical Union. She's also a member of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences and the Academia Sinica of Taiwan. In 2004, she was awarded the AGU, or American Geophysical Union, Roger Revell Medal, which is one of the highest honor in Earth and atmospheric sciences. Well, basically, listing all of these accolades of hers may still feel a little bit impersonal to the general audience here, so may I add a few more personal notes? As junior researchers in atmospheric sciences, me and my colleagues really look upon Professor Ines Fung as our role model and mentor. We admire her for her tenacity and courage to break traditional disciplinary boundaries, to really bring across different scientists together to work on complex environmental issues. We admire her for her vast knowledge in the subject area and her passion in knowing more about our environment. and also to really challenge the status quo. She has really been an inspiration for the next generation of atmospheric and climate scientists. So today, she will talk to us about plants, water, and climate. As many of us may know, afforestation, you know, regrowing trees, has been a good thing. It has been proposed as a mechanism for reducing atmospheric carbon dioxide level and slow climate warming. So today, she's going to tell us various aspects of experiments with a global climate model and also exciting observations about plants, water, and climate. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Ines Fung.
Thank you very much, Amos, for the very kind introduction. It really is a pleasure for me to be here, and I thank the United College for giving me this opportunity and the honor of being a distinguished scholar here. I have been here, this is my second week working here, and I have the pleasure of meeting many of the faculty here and the next generation, and I'm really impressed with the next generation, and I look forward to your telling me what I'm done is not so correct, and you have new ideas, and this is how we go forward. So I thank you very much for my being here, and I look forward to being here again. So what I want to talk about is plants, water, and climate, and as Amos said, the growing trees, afforestation, has been proposed as a mechanism to reduce CO2 in the atmosphere and help with the climate change problem. So before I go ahead, I want to say a lot of it is I'm doing karaoke. A lot of the work is done with the graduate students. Abby Swan, Jung Un Lee, and Percy Ling have graduated, and the two more, Jasper and Daniela, they'll be graduating this fall. And Bill Dietrich, I want to point out, is not an atmospheric scientist. He's a geomorphologist, and he has paid me the highest compliment. He says, now I'm looking up, okay? And Todd Dawson is a plant physiologist, and he's taught me a lot. But before I talk about climate, before I talk about plants, this is the latest temperature record from 2014, and so this is the land, and this is departure from the 1981 to 2010 average. So this is about five Celsius warmer, and this is 5 Celsius, blue is 5 Celsius colder, and you can see that most of the globe is much warmer, except where the politicians live in the United States. Okay, so this is an unfortunate patch. We can look at the temperature in a slightly different way by looking at the record. So you can see the record warming. Alaska was so warm that they had to postpone the Iditarod. There were ski resorts that were closed, but the politicians were very cold. They were cold. Much cooler than normal, whereas the west coast of the US and the rest of the world, most of the rest of the world is warmer than normal. We can look at the temperature record in yet another way, average over the entire globe. And so you can see from 1880 to 2010, the blue dots is the yearly average, departure again from the 18, departure from that record, our average. But the red is the decadal average. So you can see it's getting warmer and warmer and warmer. So if you're over 17 years old, you would have lived through the warmest 10 years in the last 130-odd years. So you can see 2014 ranked as the top, the hottest year here. And you can see the rest of them. And you remember the rest of them. So when I look at summer temperatures, here is a different way of showing the temperature record. So if we say 1951 to 1980 is our normal, so we have a bell curve, a Gaussian distribution around this, and so this is the green dotted line that is repeated decade after decade. So you can see from decade to decade from here that the whole temperature distribution has shifted to warmer. And what was very rare, extreme warm events, which is the 100-year event, this is the 0.01, it's the 1,000-year event, now is happening much more frequently. Okay, so this is seeing, you can see, not only is the average going, shifting to warmer, but the spread is bigger. Okay, so the extremes are more extreme. Now, obviously, this is due to our addition of CO2 to the atmosphere. And I think last time I showed you, CO2 is a molecule, CO2. So given the right wavelength, it can vibrate. Okay, so how does CO2 absorb energy? So then it can vibrate. It can vibrate like this. It can vibrate like this. Okay, and so then the energy that's coming from the Earth goes into the CO2. But CO2 is only present, the concentration of CO2 is about 0.04% in the atmosphere. So the CO2 bumps into, the excited CO2 bumps into the nitrogen, bumps into the oxygen, transfers the energy to the nitrogen and the oxygen, and so we have the greenhouse effect. Okay, so the greenhouse effect is just the right wavelength, and this is the energy from the Earth at the right wavelength that gets the CO2 molecules into excited states, okay, and that transfers the energy to the other molecules. The other important molecule that we have to think about is water vapor. So water vapor is a much more potent gas. And look at its vibration. It is like this, and I can't even do the water vapor thing. Okay, so it can turn, it can do. Okay, it has many degrees of freedom. And so it is much more abundant. Unlike CO2, which is present at 0.04%, this is 1 to 2% in the atmosphere. Much more abundant, and it has many more degrees of freedom. Therefore, it's a much more potent greenhouse gas. So if we add CO2 to the atmosphere, so first thing we have is warming, okay? Now the warming will cause evaporation from the oceans, okay? In the same way my laundry dries faster on a sunny afternoon, okay? They will evaporate, the warming will provide energy, and there's evaporation from the ocean, and so there's more water vapor in the atmosphere, okay? So when the water vapor is excited, and so then the water effect would enhance the initial greenhouse effect caused by the CO2. Also, warming will also decrease, will melt the snow and ice, and so that would decrease the snow cover, and so that would decrease the reflectivity of the surface in the same way, you know, you need sunglasses near snow, maybe you don't, but near snow and ice, when you go skiing, you need sunglasses because of the reflection of sunlight. So when the surface is darker, the sunlight goes into, is absorbed by the surface instead of being reflected out to space. And so there's absorption of solar energy, and that contributes to warming. So the dial is actually in the clouds. One can write poetry and one can read poetry about clouds, but trying to figure out how clouds work and trying to write equations for clouds is a different problem. So if we increase cloud cover, then that would reflect more sunlight, okay, and it would contribute to cooling. However, we're from the tropics, okay? So then the cumulus clouds are taller, they don't cover much area, and so they lose energy at a colder temperature, so then they contribute to warming. Okay, so whether what the clouds do is basically one of the major research questions that we have. Okay, whether the clouds would warm, would contribute to warming or cooling. But at the end of the day, all when we put everything together, the net is that there is, that all the water cycle is in the warming. So this is very interesting to me, because Earth is the only planet with all three phases of water, with liquid, with vapor, and with solid, okay? And so it's that shift between the three phases of water that determines, so that's the dial, okay, whether we were warm or we were cool, or how much we were warm or how much we were cool is totally in the water, okay? So this is very unique to our planet. So given all of this, and given the warming that we have experienced and that we projected to happen, we talk about mitigation. How do we avoid this? What can we do about this? Obviously, and we talk about a four-step program, and not sequential step, but everything has to go on at the same time. The obvious thing is energy efficiency. Okay, refrigerators, your computers, your TV, everything, the automobiles. About 50% of the energy that is in coal or in oil or gas is not used by any of us. Okay, but even in our consumption of energy, there's a lot of room for improving the efficiency. So reducing the wastage and improving the efficiency. The second is renewable energy. I think all of us are familiar with the idea of renewable energy: solar energy, hydroelectric, wind, biomass, geothermal energy, ocean currents, tides, waves. The issue there is the technology is not yet scalable to replace the fossil energy. Okay, so there's a lot of research that's being done now that will work to see how can we scale it up to replace fossil energy. The other things which I put in the category of, I hope we don't have to do it, but we have to figure out how to do it, is carbon capture and sequestration. And most of it, when we talk about that, we mainly think about mechanisms of absorbing CO2 from the atmosphere with some chemical trees or some new material, okay, that can absorb CO2 from the atmosphere and then put it maybe in geologic formations. And there is also a research problem, because we can't really put the CO2, liquid CO2, into the ground because it's very acidic, and so that may leach out mercury or arsenic or other things. So we have to find the right geologic structure for that. But the last resort is geoengineering, which is, for example, this is still in the science fiction space in my mind, where you throw aerosols, like pretend you can have your own personal volcano, you fly into the stratosphere and throw aerosols and reflect sunlight. If we go that route, we have to do it forever, okay, because the minute we stop doing it, the warming will kick in very rapidly. So we have talked about these programs, you know, and a lot of research being done to improve energy efficiency to do all of that. But one thing which is easier to do that we have talked about is growing trees, afforestation. Okay, obviously, the trees photosynthesize and they remove CO2 from the atmosphere. You see a tree, I see carbon stored, okay, in the tree. I see carbon stored in the soil. Okay, so that's a good thing. Not only do we like trees, it's a good thing for the climate. But what I want to talk about today is how it's a thought experiment. What are the climatic consequences of growing trees? Okay, and these are very large, dramatic experiments. And so then, what are the strategies? What are for effective climate mitigation? So most people say, look at the tree, a lot of carbon. We should do it. Okay, so before we go there, this is a review, high school stuff. That photosynthesis, this is a stomate, there's a stomate here. And so the CO2 goes in, this is photosynthesis, but water comes out. Okay? The plants transpire water. I mean, not only, in the same way I need to sweat. Okay? It's, the production of carbohydrate is very energy, it generates a lot of heat. So you really don't want to overheat. Okay? So in the same way I need to sweat. Okay? If I don't sweat, I overheat. Okay, so this is one way for the plants to cool themselves, to have the liquid converted to vapor and the vapor escape. So again, this is the review. What I just said is that for liquid to go to vapor, we have evaporation, and so the wet surface supplies the energy to vaporize the water. Okay, so and that cools the surface. My mother always told me, don't go out with wet hair. Okay, why? I'll catch a cold, right? What do you mean? What does she mean? Okay, so when I come out with wet hair, and then later on, my hair is no longer wet. The liquid has become vapor. Who is providing the energy? Okay, I'm providing the energy to vaporize the liquid, okay, to vapor. In the same way, so then I would catch a chill because I'm losing energy. Okay, so in the same way on a hot afternoon, you want to spray yourself with water because you want to evaporate, okay, so you want to cool. So water, you think about water, I think about water as an energy carrier, okay? So when evaporation, we're taking energy from the ocean, storing it in the water vapor, okay? And when it condenses, when you see clouds and write poetry, I see the release of latent heat, okay? And so that warms the atmosphere. So the water vapor, this evaporation condensation, okay, is a way of transferring energy from the ocean to the atmosphere. It's a way to cool the ocean, okay, and it's a way to heat the atmosphere. So now when I look at the energy balance, then what we have is the sunlight, okay, shortwave energy. This is solar energy. So this is the sunlight. So how much sunlight is absorbed by the surface depends on how reflective the surface is, how dark it is or how bright it is. Okay, that's the albedo. The word albedo means whiteness. Okay, so how white or how reflective it is. Now, so we went through the long wave, which is terrestrial energy, the greenhouse effect. So now if we have CO2 in the atmosphere, if we have water vapor in the atmosphere, then there's more downward radiation, and so then it contributes to the warming. Okay, so the other way to cool is evapotranspiration and transpiration by trees. And what I just said is that would cool the surface, and when the water vapor condenses, we would warm the atmosphere. So the remainder is what I call the sensible heat. It's not sensible as in not coming out with wet hair, but sensible as what we can feel, okay, that can be sensed. Okay, so sensible heat you can think about as dry heat. So this is basically the remainder of the energy balance. Okay, so we have sunlight coming in, we have the greenhouse effect, and then we have cooling by evaporation and maybe by sensible heat. But this would heat directly the atmosphere. And you know, if I don't water my plants, so if I have higher CO2, then if I have higher CO2 in the atmosphere, then I have warmer temperature because of the greenhouse effect, okay, excited molecules. And so the stomates will close in the same way if I don't water my plants, it will, on a hot afternoons, they close up. Then there's less evaporation, and so the shift will go to sensible heating or the dry heating. So then the energy balance will go to heating the atmosphere. So I started with heating, and I end up with more heating if the stomates close. Okay, so we have a loop. Okay, so also when the stomates close, then there's less transpiration, there's less water lost to the atmosphere. So in a soil situation, then there's more runoff. Okay, there could be more runoff. So this is the background, okay? So you can see what plants will do, basically evaporation, okay, the energy balance. So a lot of it on land, the temperature on land is dependent on whether we have got trees or we don't have trees. And you know that from your experience. It's always cooler near, you know, in a vegetated area. So now I switch gears and I talk about several climate model experiments. And so this is a suppose, okay, I have a big toy model, I have this. And so then you say, what would happen in the Arctic if I replace all the bare ground with deciduous trees? Or I'll do another experiment where in mid-latitudes, suppose I replace all croplands and grasslands with deciduous trees. Obviously, we're not going to do that. But this is a thought experiment that we're doing, okay? And so this is a calculation, thermodynamic ocean, etc. So you can look in the Arctic, this is Abby Swan's photo, that we have evergreen trees and we have deciduous trees. And evergreen trees are darker than the deciduous trees. Okay, so they reflect more sun. The deciduous trees reflect 15% of the sunlight. These guys, the evergreen trees, only 8% of the sunlight. And so then, but the evergreen trees transpire less than the deciduous trees, okay? These guys transpire more. So we're gonna put deciduous trees on the background. So this is the area that we converted to deciduous trees. So this is the area, it's about 2.5 times the size of Alaska in the Arctic, that's bare ground, and we just say, suppose I can grow trees. Suppose I put deciduous trees everywhere. What would happen? So it warms, which is a surprise, because I said if we planted trees, there's evaporation and we should cool. So I said to Abby Swan, who's now a professor at the University of Washington, I said, you must have a coding error. She says, no, I don't. Okay, so we went through. This is a long struggle. But you know, the warming is not just over the area where that has been, where the trees have been added, okay? The warming, so the afforestation area is this, and the warming is like in over the ocean and other parts. And so this is where when you look at the water vapor, then the warming is coincident with the water vapor. Okay, so what do you think happened? We put trees, we put more, there's more transpiration into the atmosphere. Okay, now remember the greenhouse gas, okay, water vapor. So here is a schematic. You can see I spend too much time at airports. So we have trees, okay, so there's less, it's darker than the snow, so it gets warmer, absorb more sunlight. And then we have evapotranspiration because we put trees, so there's more water vapor in the atmosphere. And water vapor is a greenhouse gas, so there's more downward radiation. So we enhance the greenhouse effect with that. Now, the water vapor is advected over the Arctic Ocean, so that melts the sea ice. So this was the sea ice before, and now we melt the sea ice. So now the sea ice is brighter than the dark ocean. So we absorb more, so we absorb more sunlight and we have more evaporation from the open ocean, okay, the ice-free ocean. So this goes on, okay? So what we have by growing trees in the bare ground, at least in the model, is that we amplify the initial warming, okay, because of the water vapor, and then by the melting of the sea ice, that the whole thing magnifies. So here at the end, we have a warmer, less ice, and warmer climate. Now, suppose I change gears and go to the mid-latitudes where we live. Suppose I replace our cropland and grassland in mid-latitudes with deciduous trees. What do you think would happen? Will we warm or will we cool? So it turns out that we warm also, but for a totally different reason. So when we have warmer, widespread warming in the northern hemisphere, it's darker. We put trees everywhere, and so the surface is darker, so we have more sun, we absorb more sunlight, but we have little assist. The ice is not a big deal. But what happens is that when we run out of water in the soil, you know, they grow grass, and I insisted that we have to grow trees where trees probably won't grow. Okay, we run out of water, and so then the energy balance shifts to the sensible heat or the dry heating. Okay, so that heats the atmosphere. So when I don't have evaporation, it's like me if I don't sweat. Okay, I'm going to overheat. Okay? So what happens is that this is heating by that dry heat, okay, that sensible heating, and so this is widespread. Is that the end of the story? Obviously not. Okay, so when we look at satellite pictures, often we see this beautiful line of clouds along the equator. Okay, this is the intertropical convergence zone, and it marks the thermal equator. So the air from the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere come together, okay, where there's warm ocean, and so they rise. So this is where the rain belts are. Okay, so there's a rising motion, and that circulation is the Hadley cell. Okay, so this is the rising motion. So I want to show you, now this is exciting for me, satellite observation of the rain belts, okay, of rain. So you can see the rain belt, but note how they shift with season. Okay, the rain belt is further north in the northern hemisphere in the northern winter, okay, and it is in the southern, the rising motion is in the southern hemisphere in the southern winter. Okay, basically, the winter circulation is the stronger one. The winter circulation is the one that extends to the other hemisphere to move heat from the warm hemisphere to the cold hemisphere. So when we do this, when we warm one hemisphere by planting trees, running out of water, we warm one hemisphere relative to the other, then what happens is the rain belt shifts. Okay, so we didn't want to do anything to the southern hemisphere, but by planting trees up here, we changed the energy balance between the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere. And so the rain belts, the circulation changes, and so then we have more rain. So this is the rain belt shifting to the warmer hemisphere, and so there's less rain here. The red is less rain, and the blue is more rain. So you can see the rain belt shifting. And so with the rain belt shifting, even though we say we wanted to grow trees to store carbon, which we would do if we could do it, is that the drying would reduce the productivity. So there would be less carbon stored where there is drying and not just where we planted trees. Okay. So I want to get through the idea that the whole planet is connected. We do one thing here, okay, there are consequences elsewhere. Okay, so we call this eco-climate teleconnection, borrowing from Professor Gabriel Lau's thesis advisor, the teleconnection. So this is an eco-climate teleconnection where we do something here that if it is large enough scale, it influences the entire atmosphere, it changes the productivity elsewhere. So one might say that the large scale afforestation, even accounting for the decrease in productivity, decrease in the southern hemisphere, in the southern parts of the Amazon, here, if I plant all those trees, I could store a lot of carbon. Okay? I could store 230 petagram. That's slightly over 100 ppm. It's really big deal. Okay? If I could do that, it's really big deal. Okay? So you expect a cooling of about 1 to 2 degrees. Okay? In the long run. However, you know I'm a scientist. I always say, however, okay? However. However, the decrease in the atmosphere, the trees grow on 30-year, 50-year time scales, okay? You can decrease the CO2 on decadal time scale. However, you decrease the CO2 in the atmosphere, now there is less pressure difference pushing CO2 into the ocean. So then there is outgassing from the ocean, okay? And that happens on a 100, 200, 300-year time scale. So in the long haul, when I look at 100, 200, 300-year time scale, then by planting trees, a lot of work to warming, we only decrease the CO2 about 30 to 50 petagrams, which is about 20 parts per million, which is not much, okay? So not enough. So this is insignificant in the long haul. Okay, so I want to emphasize, planting trees is a good thing. Okay, it may be a short-term solution, maybe 30 years, okay, but not a long-term solution to anything. So now if we go to the tropics, there's a particular feature of trees that I had no clue about, and it's called hydraulic redistribution. So tap roots have bigger, if you do a cross-section of tap roots, they have bigger openings in the tap roots. So in the daytime, what we expect is that the tap roots suck water from wherever they are, okay, and then also water is sucked in from the near surface by the fine roots, because that's where the nutrients are. Okay, so then it goes up the tree and then to supply the photosynthesis and transpiration. So there's a particular feature which has been measured in many trees is that after a rainstorm, the taproots actually suck the water to great depth. And this is called hydraulic redistribution. Okay, and I call it offshore banking. Okay, so you hide the water, and the trees have this capability of sucking the water, hiding it from the atmosphere, and only pulling up, okay, where it is needed, the hydraulic lift to the surface, and then this happens. Okay, so the water, instead of being near the surface, accessible for evaporation and therefore drying by evaporation, the trees have this capability of sucking the water, okay, hydraulic, some trees, many species, not all species, but many species have this capability of pulling the water away, okay, hiding it from the atmosphere, okay, and stashing it, stashing it when it is needed. And so when we put this into the climate model, then when we have hydraulic redistribution, then this evapotranspiration increases and the temperature decreases. And this is actually a surprising discovery in the Amazon. Because when we look at the Amazon, we talk about the Amazon, the rainy season and the dry season. The rainy season and the dry season are defined by when precipitation, when it's rainy, okay, not when the soils are dry. So when my colleagues went to the Amazon, what they found is that there is greatest photosynthesis during the dry season than during the wet season, okay? Because during the rainy season, there's cloud cover all the time, okay, there's not enough sunlight to power photosynthesis. And during the dry season, because we have this private stash of water, okay, at depth, okay, now we have abundant sunlight and we have hidden the water away from the atmosphere. So that can fuel photosynthesis. And that's really observed and is really exciting that we have figured this out before they observed it. So in summary, what we say is if we enhance transpiration or if we plant trees, the different processes come in to change the climate. So in the Arctic, there's enhanced greenhouse effect and more evaporation of water, and so that contributes to a warming. In the mid latitudes, when we run out of water, then we have dry heating or sensible heating, and that warms. And so it's in the tropics when we have abundant water, and so the transpiration would cool. Okay, so this is totally different processes. So I don't need to go through all of this. So if we have excess, so the key to everything is access to water. Okay. Mid-latitude, tropics is access to water. So where is the water to sustain tree growth? What I told you is totally a modeling exercise. You can tell me the model is wrong. You can tell me it's inadequate. But where is the water? So I didn't know what to do. And my friends are not measuring deep water. So I wrote a proposal, and I think I've offended a few people with this proposal. I said precipitation and stream flow represents the excess water the atmosphere and the soils cannot hold. And measurement of these surpluses do not tell us anything about the origin of the water, the transformation, or anything that happens to the water. And I said using, at the time, the way that they were measuring tools, which is going out, some of you do this, okay, so going out and measuring for a few days and then coming home, it's like listening to a Beethoven symphony, but hearing only a single note every minute. Okay, so we propose a totally new way of looking at the water. And so I call that, the proposal was the life cycle of water. So we have this field site in Northern California. The University of California has about 40 reserves. And so we're going to Northern California. And if you know California, this is just north of Mendocino. And so it's winter rain, and the size of the site was chosen, this is not totally logical, so that PhD thesis, that for the lifetime of a PhD thesis, we can get a result, okay? So it's a very small watershed. So this is what it looks like, big trees, and the creek is down here, and very steep site. And so we did, and this is one of the few pictures of me in the field. I'm afraid of heights, and this is, I don't go hiking, and so one of the few. But anyway, so here I am. This is Jim. He's an oceanographer, aquatic chemistry. Mary Power is the director, and she studies river insects. Todd Dawson is a plant physiologist. Jim Kirchner studies stream flow, and Bill Dietrich studies geomorphology. So it's a bunch of people who don't know how to talk to one another, who have no clue what the languages are about. They say big words to me, and I don't know what the big words are. And I say, can you write me an equation? And they stare at me like, what? Okay. So it took a few, but it was a deliberate thing on my part to have only a few people. And everyone say, oh, we want to measure CO2. I say, no. I need to do the water first. Okay, so it took us a few years to at least get through the language issue and the approaches of the different fields. And so what we did is we drill wells and we had core things and we put in sensors, and this is important. We put in, with that proposal, we put in Wi-Fi towers, we put in solar panels, and so everything, all the sensors are there. And so we have, in a very small area, we've got over 1,000 sensors. Now the area has expanded and they are reporting data every 5 minutes or so. Okay, and they stream home, and I can go to the web now and see what is happening, except nothing's happening because we're in a drought. Okay, but we can see everything, okay, within 30 minutes, and that's done so that we save power. Okay, but we can stream in real time. So we have soil moisture, and Jim Bishop automated the entire water collection, so we have daily chemistry so that he can sit from home and tell the sensors to pump water, etc. So they collect water samples and rain gauges, and we sat flow out, show some. Anyway, so we've got a lot of sensors and a lot of things going on. So what I'm going to show you, just a few things. This is just our drilling. You can see the slope in drilling wells. And we drilled now about 10 wells. More than that, I lost count. But here, this first data that came in is that this well at the top of this particular place is 18, the water table was 18 meters below the surface. When it rained, it flew up. The water table went up by a meter. That's very fast. All the models that I have go slowly as percolation. No way can it go that fast. Okay, and we can look at all the other wells, and now we've got many years of data. This is the color is different wells. So you can see not all the wells, this is a well by the stream, but most of them, just when it rains, they all go up very quickly, okay, and then there's a recession, and then when it rains, it goes up and it goes up, okay. So basically what we have, and I put that there, is a secret passageway for the water, okay, not just slow percolation. And so we have students, and this is Daniela Rempe, and so we have a neutron probe. Neutron probe is something that we use to detect water on Mars, okay, so changes in the hydrogen. And so at the end, I won't go through, but she goes out and she camps out there, and so it senses the water, the hydrogen, within a 1 foot diameter. And so you slowly lower it into all the wells, okay, foot by 1 foot. So 20 meters is a long way to go. So anyway, so she's done a lot of that, but I will just go quickly to say what the picture that we have is that there's soil up top, but you have weathered bedrock here. And so this is my secret passageway. So the storms, when the first storms come, the water can go down, okay? And so the water table would go up. And so So the winter storm, so there's we expect the water to be saturated here and saturated at the bottom, and unsaturated zone in the middle. So this is a surprise also. And when we estimate the rock, what we call rock moisture, from below the soil to the water table is 30%. So here is a secret bank account of water, right? We have seen this water, 30%, and if the roots extend down, then they can access that. Okay, so since we have fractures, the roots will grow where there's water. at the roots, so then we expect the roots will expand the fractures and facilitate the passage, the passage of water. So now we look at the trees. So here is the sap flow sensor. So this is going up the tree. Sap flow sensor is the thing you put, a prong you stick into the tree. And so there's a heat pulse in the middle. So whether the so how fast the heat transfers up or down, you figure out the transpiration. So here's the first storm, and this particular Douglas fir went up very rapidly, response to the rain. But when we look at a few trees, what we see is what I saw Douglas fir is that here's the rain, it goes up and it goes around like that. They're tall. And so as soon as the rains come, there's transpiration. That means photosynthesis, okay? So there's water, there's transpiration, there's photosynthesis. And it slowly declines in the summer, in the dry summer. Madrone is this curious tree, beautiful tree, orange bark. This maximum sap flow or maximum transpiration is in the dry summer when the soils are dry, okay? And so the question is, where do they get water? And so here's the live oak, and they sort of slowly ramp up and then during the wet season and then slowly ramp down during the dry season. So what we find here is that there are some tree species that can deal with, that can survive the droughts. Okay, there's some tree species, probably, and I say probably because we haven't done the measurement, we don't know how to dig up, how to do that non-destructively. Maybe using geophysical instruments, we can figure out the root density. But we hypothesize that the madrones that transpire in the summer have deep roots. They can access that water, that rock moisture, and so they can survive. And so they can survive extended droughts. They're still transpiring now. Okay, so the story is to gain maximum benefit from planting trees. Okay, climate benefit from planting trees. We really need to figure out where the water is, and not just where the water, and not just where the precipitation is, but underground. Okay, not just in the upper layer, but deep in the groundwater. So here we're looking at the groundwater. In California, 80% of the freshwater use is in agriculture. California produces about 45% of the fruits and vegetables in the US. Okay, it's a big deal. We're in a fourth year of a drought, and the rains that happened yesterday didn't go into the ground. There are landslides in Los Angeles, okay? So we want the water to go down, okay? To go into the high secret hiding places down there. But just went off and there's mudslides and everything. So when we look at the agriculture use, then a lot of it is supplied by groundwater. So we can also look, for example, in Saudi Arabia. This is a Landsat photograph from May. You can see these little green dots. So if I magnify this green dot, you can see the irrigation. Okay, so they are accessing. We don't know how old, 10,000, 20,000, 30,000, much older water that's in the ground. Okay, so here we are familiar with our wells and drilling, but it's very difficult to measure, to figure out where the groundwater is, how the groundwater is, how it's being used, or whether there's enough groundwater. Now we have a new satellite. It's not new anymore, but it's called GRACE, the Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. It's just two satellites, okay, flying in formation, and they're about 220 kilometers apart. So when it goes over, when it's approaching land or some large mass, then there's acceleration on the lead satellite, so the separation between the two increases just by a little bit, not anything that you would see, okay? But so the lead satellite, so then you can tell, and then the second one approaches, and then it catches up. So by that difference, okay, in the two satellites going flying over the Earth, then we can figure out where the masses are. Okay, and so after, because mountains don't change from day to day and from season to season and seamounts, you can subtract out, okay, the stationary component, and so the seasonal variation is basically due to the loading of water. Okay, so we don't know whether it is snow or ice, but now we can look at this, and I'm going to accelerate this movie. So this is an animation. So the crucial thing is that yellow and red represent areas where storage is below normal. So we go, oops, what happened here? So we will do this. So here is Australia, and I'm going to move it fast so you can see Australia, the depletion of groundwater in Australia as time goes on. Now we go to California, and so you can see this is January 2004 when the satellite went into operation. You can see the depletion of groundwater in California. It makes me very sad. In the Middle East, the same thing happens. So here is a lot of water, and again, the depletion. In India, oops, here's India. Same thing happens. So you can see the depletion now from this spectacular, to me, it's just a spectacular measurement of the changes in the loading of water on Earth. So you can see the depletion. So when you look at all the data together, then you can calculate a trend. And so basically the blue is where there's enough rainfall, not just the depletion. And so the red, this is severe, obviously. The red and the orange areas are where there is depletion, very rapid depletion, and they call it in distress. So one third of the big groundwater basins are in distress. So we are using groundwater. Okay, we think we have an inheritance, again, in the same way we think a fossil fuel is an inheritance from 100 million or more years ago. Here there is water, okay, inheritance from past generations, past, I don't know how long ago. So, and we're depleting it. So the question is, what do we do? So there's several obvious strategies, you know, agricultural management, efficient use of water. So obviously this is a beautiful picture of sprinklers, and you shouldn't be doing that, okay, because there's evaporation. I have replaced in my garden, not that I'm watering anything anymore, we're not allowed to water grass in the drought, but I have replaced all the with drip irrigation. Okay, so we bury all of that. So there's more. First is just reduce the loss from evaporation. Second, obviously, is manage the water table. And so in agricultural fields, they actually move the water table, manage the water table up and down to optimize the development of roots. You know, you want, and so you don't want surface runoff like what is happening in after a long drought. The rain comes and it doesn't go into the soil. It just slides off and there's erosion and everything. And so the other thing is the runoff, subsurface runoff. In all agricultural fields, there's a little a pipe somewhere down there that's for the runoff, and that takes nutrients out to the ocean. So what it's also done, the engineering, there are many engineering options, but what the GRACE satellite has done is to inform farmers or large agricultural practices where you are, the status of groundwater, and how you plan. Okay, I'm not going to talk about policy, but anyhow. So there are also untapped sources of fresh water, and this is for people. Oops. I just saw water, as I have water on my brain. So desalination of seawater, okay, and brackish groundwater, and that's doable. I was in Antarctica, and so what they do is they pull water from the ocean, and they have a reverse osmosis place, a plant, and so then they reserve one quarter, they use three quarters of the water, the fresh water they produce, they save one quarter of the fresh water, and that fresh water is mixed with the water with the water from the sewage treatment plant, and the salt is added back in, and that's put back into the ocean. So that's operational. Nobody told me to not take showers when I was in Antarctica. So you can have, you can use as much hot water as you want. Okay, so that's it. The technology exists. And so there's also recovery of groundwater impaired by previous anthropogenic activity. So there's the pollution, and I'm a horrible example, is fracking, where we put a lot of water into the ground and it gets filthy, it gets all polluted. But there's, now we're putting a lot of water into the ground, and there could be ways to recover that water. And there's also upstream or underground storage, you know, so from seasonal, where you have how do you store the water and not let it evaporate, etc. So there's recovery of rainwater and stormwater runoff. Now just the drains just run into the back into the ocean. And then there's grey water use that we certainly are familiar with. And then the reuse of municipal water effluent. So I want to end here to say that afforestation, planting trees, is a good thing. Okay, we all like trees. It's a good thing. We want our green space. Okay, but it's a good and necessary, probably necessary, short-term climate management strategy for maybe for 30 or 50 years, as long as we manage the water. Okay, we cannot let the soil dry and then everything warms up. Okay, but afforestation is not a long-term climate solution. Okay, so when I look at the climate issue, I'm always thinking I'm thinking energy, you know, temperature, water, carbon, they all come in a single package. Okay, there's no such thing as just working on water or just working on carbon. Okay, everything, you have to do the whole thing together because they're totally linked. Okay, to reduce the carbon, I need to know where the water is, how to grow the trees, and not let the soils dry up. Okay. Etc. So I'll end by showing you this. A colleague of mine made this. Water vapor. You know, water vapor. You look at this. It's a beautiful. This is a model. This is a high-resolution model. You can see water vapor in the air. You don't see it, but this is a visualization. I see this, and I see greenhouse effect, okay? And I see the possibility of the condensation. If they go up high enough, there could be rain, okay? I could see all sorts of stuff. So water, again, we are the planet with three phases of water. We're the planet with abundant water. And so the water is the dial in the system. Water is essential to life. And this is, so you can see, this is, I'll stop here. This is showing off the computers, the high resolution. Okay, so I'll stop right here. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Feng, for the interesting and enlightening talk. Please be seated in the front. I'm sure that there will be some questions on the floor. May I now call upon Professor Amos Tai, moderator of today's lecture, to host the question and answer session for us. Professor Tai, please.
First, thank you very much, Ines, for this wonderful and insightful talk. I myself am truly intrigued by the very intricate interactions between plants, water, and climate. I'm sure the audience here definitely are tingling with questions, which we'll definitely like to entertain, right? So it's your time, it's your floor. Please take it away. May we entertain some questions from the audience. Yes, please.
Thank you. Okay. Oh, all right. So thank you, Professor, for a very interesting talk. So definitely, you're pointing out that the holistic approach is very important. My question is actually, how do you know that you have covered all the parameters, all the important parameters in your predictions and model building and so on?
You live and learn. And so what I'm always looking for is I'm a theoretician. So you dream about how the planet should work, you study and you figure out how to put the pieces together. And then I'm always looking for new data to say I was right and then I can sleep better, or I was wrong and then I get all excited and there's a new puzzle to solve. So what is difficult in what we're doing and in the future is that we are observing the planet as it is changing. So it is not like I'm doing a physics experiment, I can do it 3 times, 10 times and get the same answer. There's no repeat of what we have done. So we are observing, we're predicting as we are observing. So I kept saying that nature is smarter than all of us put together. And so that's where, to me, the frequency monitoring, all of that is always revealing something unique and special that, gee, we never thought of that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's how science progresses. So the projections that we use, I use the word prediction, that's not the right thing. The projection that we use, that's why I use the term scenario, mm-hmm. is say, what if we did this? What if we did that? What could happen? Okay, and so then we could plan accordingly. This is the generation, I'm looking at the students. You know, this is the generation where you understand, we have some understanding of what is happening, and this is the generation that you can do something about the future. And so I can't blame my mother, because all that happened, the fossil fuel combustion and all of that, they didn't know the consequences. Okay, here we are learning what the consequences of our actions. And so what future we want, I think the students, it's your generation, it's your future, and it is up to you to decide how you want to what your future ought to be and what actions you take. I like this field because I'm always wrong and there's always a new puzzle, okay? I think this should happen and nature always surprises me.
Oh yeah, that's why I'm asking. So you keep on adding parameters and from the
observations. Yeah, as we learn new things, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Shall we have another question? All right, please.
Hear me?
I can hear you, but I don't
know. Now, I have two questions. Number one, in the past, long ago, so we have experienced about 8 degrees rise in temperature before. Mm-hmm. So that was before human beings appeared, is what I mean. So what are the factors that would lead to recovery to the normal state, so-called normal state? Number one question. And second one, I'm interested in your three experiments, the models, the Arctic, the temperate, and also the tropics. You consider about the above ground change in temperatures, evaporation, and also evapotranspiration, these things. What about soil, the soil part? Because I think it is equally important about the humus. The humus contribute by planting trees in afforestation, you see what I mean? And humus is made up of different components. And some of the components, for example, the human part, the turnover rate is over 1,000 years. So I wonder why, will you consider adding this parameter into your modeling? Yeah. Because soil is the second largest carbon sink in the world. So humus is the most important thing in soil, in that aspect. So what do you think? Yeah. Thank you.
So the first question is, in the past when there's very high CO2 in the atmosphere, it was also very warm. Okay, and then the CO2 slowly goes into the ocean. The time scale for the CO2 removal is about 100, 200, 300 years. Okay, but the ultimate stays in the ocean, and the ultimate sink or the ultimate removal is when they settle into the sediments. And that's of order 100,000 years or 200,000 years. So that's a long, you know, so when you look at geologic time in millions of years, okay, then that's the ultimate sink. Okay, so then you have plate tectonics, that carbon goes subducted at the edges of the continents and then comes back out in volcanoes, in volcanic eruptions. So that cycle is 100,000, 200,000 years and longer. Okay, so that's the ultimate. So it took a long time to for the CO2 to come down from the high levels that they were. So the question, the second question is, I didn't talk about the model. I've got 9 boxes of soil. We have detritus, we have lignin components, and we have old carbon. So we have soil components of different time scales. So the leaves would have a turnover time of 2 to 5 years, say, on average. And then there's a litter that turnover 2 to 5 years, and then we have woody debris, and then we have older carbon, et cetera, et cetera. We have 1,000-year-old. So in the model I didn't talk about, we've got all of that. So when I say there's a carbon storage, I talk about the whole biosphere, in the above-ground biomass as well as the below-ground biomass. So I'm sorry I didn't talk about it, but we have all of that. Yeah.
Yeah, right. Another question from the audience? Okay, please, Professor Chu.
Professor Fong, very enlightening and stimulating talk.
Thank you.
The obvious take-home message is afforestation is not a long-term climate solution. But if I isolate cities, which is a very different ecosystem, is this still true?
I mean, it's always cooler where there are trees, right?
Yeah.
So it's a good thing. It's always a good thing to have trees.
And
trees take up CO2 and release oxygen.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the second question is, you look at plant, but plant vary from species to species.
Yes.
So just take evapotranspiration as an example. So some species will evaporate less or transpire less than others. So if this factor is taken into account, do you think your model still holds?
Yes, I think so. Because what I'm talking about is a quantitative. I did a very extreme case. And I did the extreme case because where I am, there's a whole energy group, and they wanted to plant poplars. And poplars grow very rapidly. And we said, oh, no, you can't plant poplars, even though because they use a lot of water, and they transpire a lot of water, and that's why we started this whole calculation. So, yes, the challenge is figuring out which species. For example, what I showed with the madrones versus the Douglas firs, I would have planted madrones rather than planted Douglas firs because they can survive in the drought, they don't transpire less, but then they're smaller trees. So there's a trade-off that we're beginning to look at. And so I hope that what we have done will stimulate the kind of research, the kind of exploration. It's not just, we should plant trees. Okay? Now we should ask, what kinds of trees, how do they transpire, where do they have what is their root structure, what water do they use, okay? And so I think it is an open area of research.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
And I hope you can tell me the answer.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I actually have a question following up with Professor Schuster, a really good question. So as you have mentioned and we have already discussed, and it's like the effect of planting trees on climate really depends on the availability of water, right? And
everything
then, as we are talking about planting trees in cities or elsewhere, water is a resources that we really treasure and that can often be running out of, or lacking in city regions. So do you have any suggestion for instance, city planners or governments?
Gray water. Use gray water.
Gray water. Can you explain a little bit more?
When you take a shower, you collect the water. When you do dishes, you collect the water, and then you go out and you use that to water the trees. Okay, so instead of letting the water run down the drain, you collect the water. Okay? So that's what I mean by efficient use and minimizing waste.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
Oh.
Thanks Thank you, Professor Fung. I just wanted to say I'm an anthropologist, so I come from a very different background, and I just wanted to say thank you for being a great communicator, because even I can understand what you're talking about. So, and my first question is, the first lecture, you gave a great talk about CO2. Here you've brought water into the equation. I was wondering, briefly mentioned aerosols, and I was wondering if you could talk just for a second about that, because in China we talk about aerosols all the time.
Yes.
In terms of smog, air. Yes. Pollution. I just gave a talk about this recently, because we don't think of aerosols connected to climate change very often, but they definitely are, I think. Yes. And
yes.
I also have one. Yeah. Other question I was wondering, would you be able to talk a little bit more about...
I'm trying to figure out how to say it very briefly. I can talk 2 hours.
I know.
Talk about a whole day. But the first thing,
yeah.
Yes, the first thing to note is that I skipped over all of this. If you have water vapor, 100% saturation, they may not condense unless you have some nucleus to condense on. Okay, because the surface tension, it requires more energy. So if you have stuff, okay, cloud condensation, stuff in the atmosphere, then it is much easier to condense the water. And so having aerosols in the atmosphere, okay, then there's condensation. But the reflectivity of aerosols is dependent on the area. So you can just say the volume, the mass is 4 over 3 pi r squared, and the area is 4 pi r squared. So you can figure that out, that if you have the same mass, if I give you the same mass of water, if you form little drops, then they are brighter. The scattering area is bigger, and therefore they are brighter and they reflect more sunlight. Okay, if you have big drops, I was at the University of Washington with Bob Charlson, and he was standing in the rain, and big drops, he says, sea salt, okay, cloud condensation nuclei, sees big drops, okay? But now if I have condensation bright, and you can see the in the satellite pictures, you can see ship tracks, okay, you can see contrails in the sky, okay, so that's condensation nuclei condensing the water vapor. But if you have little drops, they may, and I emphasize, they may hang around for a longer time, right? If you have big drops or in a turbulent area, then they may form bigger drops, okay? And so then there may be rain. So this is one of the major unknowns. One field study, one field study, they show that when it's a polluted atmosphere, then because of the drops are small, they don't fall out. And then when there's a convection, then the drops get brought to below freezing, and then the ice crystals form bigger, etc. So you actually get more intense, not more, but more intense precipitation rather than a normal atmosphere. But some places. So it's a very active research area. So when we look at aerosols, we also say, are these hygroscopic aerosols, will they grow bigger in a moist atmosphere, or will they not, or you know, etc. So right now it's a very exciting research area.
Thank you.
Yeah. Gabriel.
Yes, a lot.
Thank you, Ines, for this inspiring talk. We scientists tend to think about what we are doing is the most important problem in the world.
Yes.
So climate scientists think climate change is the number one problem facing humanity. But I was asked this question when I gave a similar talk, and a member of the audience say, are you sure that what you're working on is the most important problem? Now we tend to rank things, okay? We rank universities, we rank things we buy. How would you rank the climate change problem among so many other disciplines? I'm sure you have a very broad perspective of science in action. Do you still rank the climate change problem as the most important, urgent problem in the world?
I think the climate change problem is the most important problem for the long term. Okay, and so I think we have to, you know, short term I worry about California drought, I worry about food. And, you know, they're short-term things. You know, you worry about jobs, you worry about health care, you worry about education. There are many other things to worry about. But the long-term problem is climate change, Because what the CO2 that we have put into the atmosphere, and because of the large volume we have of water we have in the oceans, okay, the CO2 will warm the ocean and there's evaporation and the water vapor and the hydrologic cycle will kick in. So it will take a long time. The climate, even if we stop emission today, the CO2 that is in the atmosphere will continue to warm for generations. Okay? So that's why I see climate change as the most important problem. It's a multi-generational problem. It's an issue of generational justice, what we decide today versus what the future generations will inherit from us. That's the most important problem. I don't see another problem of that scale, of that duration. Yes, day to day, yes, I can rank other things. Climate change may not be high on my list day to day. Okay, but in the multi-generation, I look at the young people here, for them, I think that it has to be very high on their list of things to worry about. It's very high on the list for governments to worry about, because planning for a new reservoir, planning for infrastructure, planning for sea level rise, you know, all of that requires decades of planning to, you know, I don't get a new reservoir. I can't just have a new reservoir tomorrow or next year, right? Those things take a long time. And so that's why it's such an urgent problem, because that planning takes a long time. Is our infrastructure ready to deal with the changes?
Shall we have other questions from the audience? Last chance? Oh, okay, sure.
Yes, please.
We have some time.
I have another question, follow up to Professor G's on the species. Have you finished your study? I mean, the one in the temperate latitude.
I never finished, so I don't know.
Yeah, I expect your answer like this. Yeah, so my view is that, okay. And when you're talking about the use of, is it deciduous species, whatever?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Have you thought about using conifer? Conifer, evergreen,
yes,
one.
Yes, yes.
Because conifer in history, as also now, you see what I mean? The species, overall, they are less water demanding, for
yes.
one thing.
Yes.
And secondly, I think regarding their tissue content, they contain higher lignin.
Yes, yeah.
So lignin will stay in the soil.
Yes. Yeah.
And for longer periods of time, in a scale of 1,000 years or over. Yeah.
We consider deciduous trees exactly for the reason that they use more water. But when you look at the paleoclimate, the pollen record, you know, before I go to the pollen record, now the evidence is that the tree line in Alaska and in Russia, the tree line is moving north, and it's the deciduous trees that are moving first. Okay? And in the pollen record, let's say 11,000, 12,000 years, it's the pollen record shows that when there's warming, it's the deciduous trees that establish first, and then the coniferous trees come later. So I don't know anything, but I'm trying to be an anthropologist of trees, right? So I'm thinking that, oh, the deciduous trees come in, they transpire more water, they warm up the climate, and the whole gang can move in, okay? Now that when the whole gang sets up a nice climate, then the evergreen trees can, the coniferous trees can move in. But I don't know, I'm dreaming here. but the evidence is that the pollen record shows that it's the deciduous trees that establish first, and that's why we study. You know, we look at the deciduous trees, but a deliberate plantation. Obviously, one would not choose deciduous trees because they demand a lot more water. Okay, but then the coniferous trees would grow slower. So, a lot of work. Yeah, how do you optimize your decisions?
Right. So speaking of practical solutions, I actually have a question for Inez as well. We know that you also serve in the very influential National Science Board, which establishes national policy for scientific research in the U.S. So in the light of, you know, the coming climate conference that is coming very soon at the end of this year, can you tell us a little bit about
how to communicate with policymakers or the public about climate science, and is there any hope for anything coming out of the climate conference in the coming few months?
I would like to be optimistic, okay? So, but I said the other day is that this is the COP21. We've been doing this for a very long time. But this time, I think that at least there is an aspirational, I call Boy Scout, pledge, okay, that we will do something, which is a major advance. And so after that, I think it's the momentum, not by governments, it's by people to deal with this. And so when we talk about climate change, it's not just climate change. We talk about in the nexus of food, energy, and water systems, okay? Then the systems, and the word system hides all the decision-making, okay? How do you deal with it? How do you, you know, if even if we have made all the forecasts, I've been working on for this for a long time. In the 1980s, one of the first papers, we haven't changed our statement. Like more warming, more extreme weather, da-da-da. Okay, all of that we've been saying for decades. But I hope that when we talk about join forces with social scientists, with communication experts, then it is not just, oh, look at the climate, it's changing, okay? But how it would influence, how it would impact the food delivery, how it would impact the water, how it would impact cities. And so it would make it more personal. So it's not just these scientists, these nerds talking about stuff. Okay, but it makes it more personal to the future of the people, and it makes a difference to the future of the planet. And I think that's where we have learned not just say, oh, my stuff is like this, okay, but how the climate change relates to people. Yeah.
Thank you very much. If there's no more questions from the audience, please join me in appreciation again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Feng and Professor Tai again. To express the college's appreciation, we have prepared souvenirs for both the speaker and the moderator. May I call upon Professor Barley Mack, Associate College Head and Dean of Students, and Professor Helen Mang, Chairperson of the Distinguished Visiting Scholar Committee, to present the souvenirs. Professor Mack and Professor Mang, please. First, to our Distinguished Visiting Scholar, Professor Ines Feng. Then to Professor Amos Tai, moderator of today's lecture. Thank you, Professor Mack and Professor Mang. On behalf of United College, we thank you again for attending this lecture and wish you all a nice evening. Thank you and goodbye.